can be confused for somebody else. I've actually had people walk up to me on the street. I know you from somewhere. I know you. I've seen you before. I'm sure I have. As a matter of fact, Liam plays soccer on Thursday nights, and one of the moms says, "Don't I know you? I'm sure I've seen you before." And I'm looking at him thinking, "Ma'am, I have no clue who you are." So sometimes it can be hard to feel unique in a world where your name is common. Now, fortunately, I do know there's not a lot of Michael Andrew Murphys, but there are a few. But for us as Christians, where is our identification? Where does our ID lie? And we look for, our passports. How many of you like your passport picture? I thought, oh, we have a taker, one person. Most of us think they're kind of ugly-looking mugs, don't we? But the passport picture kind of identifies who we are visually, right? In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, I just want to read verse 17. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting at verse 17. Very quickly, we'll read the scripture, and then we'll get into the message. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 to 21. Some great verses from the Word of God. 2 Corinthians 5, verses 17 to 21. This is the Word of God. I'm reading from the New King James. Well, the Word of God says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, starting at verse 17. "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. All behold, all things have become new. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation." We get to share that great word. "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." We'll try to unpack a bunch of that this morning. Let's pray. Father, be with us as we look into your word. Guide us, we pray. Give us wisdom and understanding, and may the word that comes out be guided and directed by your Holy Spirit, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. One of the greatest fears I think people have in this day and age in particular, because it's so easy to do, is to lose your identity or have it stolen. Identity theft is very common, and it's done so simply. It shows up as an attention-getting headline on credit cards and on any kind of card we can get. It's so easy, it seems, for people to lift somebody's identity. I don't know if you've heard, but they can even put machines into debits or other machines, and they can take your number, right? And you don't even know it. And all of a sudden, your social insurance number could be gone. How many times have we heard about hackers breaking into databases and stealing it with Yahoo and banks, millions and millions of people's information? They could lose their identity so easily. Ads are on for services to monitor credit card reports to detect fraud, and for insurance plans to pay for that fraud when things are used. I just want to give you an example of something. I picked this up off an eZine article online. It says the client had a fairly common name, and I'll protect her identity by calling her Jennifer Marie Brown. Another woman with the same name was arrested and charged with theft. The police did not fingerprint her, and she was released on her own recognizance. Well, she did not show up for her arraignment, and so a warrant was issued for her arrest. Well, a short while later, this Jennifer Marie Brown ran a stop sign, and the police pulled her over. And when the officer ran her name through the database, he saw she was wanted for theft. So they arrested her and took her to jail. But this was not the right Jennifer Marie Brown. It took 5 court hearings to sort out what had happened. And eventually, a judge issued a formal statement that she was not the person being sought. She now has to carry that statement everywhere she goes, in case a police officer decides to run a background check on her. Can you imagine that? Everywhere you go, you have to have that letter saying, this is who I am. This is my identification. Identity defines, in many ways, our purpose in life, doesn't it? Think about athletes and how hard it is for them to retire. Do you know that in baseball now, at 36 and 37, you're considered old? 36, 37 years old, you're old. You're past your prime almost. Your body starts to break down, and these young up-and-coming 22 and 23-year-olds, 24-year-olds, are the ones who are the major players. Athletes have a hard time retiring for a number of reasons. Because the sport becomes their identity, so their age, their addiction to the limelight. Many athletes have to come back because they crave that attention. Their addiction to the thrill of the game, the adrenaline rush of the competition. And then for many, it's depression after retirement. They just cannot handle not being part of the sport because that sport has so identified who he or she is and was. And young people today struggle with identity. Their identities, society is causing their identities, and it has been for decades, maybe even centuries, to be tied up in how they look or who they hang out with or their marks, their likes or dislikes, or even by being bullied. Many young people are defined and define themselves by the fact that, oh, I'm being bullied. I'm not worth much. They do that. I remember a period in my life where I was mocked and bullied and made fun of simply because I believed in God and went to church. As a matter of fact, I had guys who used to wait for me on the way home to try to beat me up. Seriously. And I was young. And there were many a time when I had to run into one of my friend's house until this person left. Or these individuals, they just pushed it because I was a Christian. Now, I'll say this. By God's grace, I was able to overcome that, and they eventually left me alone. But sometimes that doesn't happen. But as important as our identity is in regards to finances and possessions, even for us as adults, there's an even more important identity based on who and what we are rather than what we physically own, right? Because often, as with the athletes, we can say, well, I do this for a living. How many times, guys, do we get together and it's, where do you work? What do you do? How much money do you make? Do you own a home? Right? And not always, but with ladies, often it's your mom, your grandma, your grandkids. You have lots of friends. You have relationships. You're a daughter. We have all of these things that identify who we are. But what happens when, guys, we retire? Where's our identity then? We're no longer the plumber, the carpenter, the bus driver, the worker. Who are we after we retire? Who are we if we lose our job? Where's our identification then? For models, it's in their looks. And when their looks go, what are they? Who are they? Who are they really? When the women, when the husband passes away or a child dies, or there's no longer that mom thing because the child has moved so far away, what is your identity then, ladies? Are you still the wife, the daughter, the friend? These identities can become the very purpose of our lives, and their loss can translate into having no reason to continue living. But fortunately, as a Christian and as a believer, we have a reason for living. Listen to this. There was a man who was walking through a forest, and one day he found this eaglet, I believe, the baby eagle, on the forest floor. Well, he was a farmer. So he picked up the eaglet and took it home and put it in the chicken coop. And he put the eagle in with the chicken coop. Well, one day this naturalist came by and he saw this eagle eating and acting like chickens. And he said to the farmer, What is this? Well, the farmer said, can't be an eagle anymore. Because look, he eats like the chickens and he acts like the chickens. But the naturalist said, look, he must have the heart of an eagle. He is an eagle. So the naturalist took the eagle out of the chicken coop and held it up and said, you are an eagle, fly. Because the eagle wasn't even flying. And the eagle looked at him and looked at the chickens and hopped back down into the chicken coop. The naturalist did not quit. He said, you are an eagle. He picked him up and took him out of there and took him to the top of a hill. And he says, you are an eagle. Spread your wings and fly. And the eagle looked at him and looked at the chicken coop. And he hopped out of his hands and hopped back into the chicken coop to hang out with the chickens again. Well, the naturalist was not frustrated. So he took him to a mountain. Took him to a high mountain, and he lifted them up. He said, you are a bird of majesty. You are the king of birds. Stretch out your wings and fly. And he held the eagle up to the sun. And all of a sudden, the eagle began to tremble, as if realizing what he really was. And with a triumphant cry, the eagle spread his wings and flew into the sky, never to return. Now, it may be that perhaps he thought about that chicken coop with a little bit of nostalgia from time to time. Oh, remember the days in the chicken coop, pecking around, hanging out with the chickens. It may be even that he might have revisited the barnyard time to time to hang out with the chickens for a little bit. But as far as anyone knows, that eagle has never returned to lead the life of a chicken, because he's an eagle. We are Christians. We have a new identity in Jesus Christ. Let me give you a before and after photo, and I'm moving as quick as I can here. All right? Before and after photos of us as non-believers and as believers. In Luke 15:24, we were dead, but now alive. We're lost, and now we're found. In Romans 6:11, we were dead in sin, but now we're alive to God. In 2 Peter 1:19, we were in darkness, but now we are a light shining in a dark place. And in 1 Corinthians 6:9 to 11, there's an exceptionally unflattering set of photos of us before. There are the sexually immoral, idolaters, adulterers, male prostitutes, homosexual offenders, thieves, greedy, drunkards, slanderers, swindlers. This is the before. That's not a pretty picture. But then it says the right side shows a person who has undergone an amazing transformation. It's a photo of us with our new identity. We are now washed, justified, sanctified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. These are wonderful pictures. One is filthy, kind of like the chicken coop, the barnyard of sin. And the other side is the beautiful, glorious, cleansing, pure presence of Jesus Christ. And we become the righteousness of him. We are washed in the blood. When Christ is invited into a person's heart, a metamorphosis begins to take place. God refers to it as becoming a new creation in Christ. It's like the caterpillar changing into the butterfly. But you say, I don't really feel different. Well, what's changed? What's changed? The old is gone is talking about the person who stood condemned under the law, dead in his sins. Do you know what the wonderful thing about being a Christian is? Is that God does not count our sin against us anymore. Can you say amen to that? Our sin is no longer held to our account. We are free from it, from the consequences of that sin, which is hell. As Christians, it is not held to our account, because Jesus became sin for us. He paid for each and every sin, the Bible says. So even as we struggle on a daily basis, know that when we sin, that's taken care of. We confess it, we repent, and we strive to live for Christ even more powerfully. It's taken care of. We don't have to wallow in the guilt of the world. The balance has been paid. And so the new has come describes a new person, one who is in good standing with God, who is righteous. That's when God puts his own son's righteousness on us. The Bible says so. We might become the righteousness of God. And God puts that on us. And suddenly we're living with new clothes, with a new person, a new being. The righteousness of God. Let me explain it this way. The butterfly isn't a caterpillar with wings, is it? Have you ever seen the caterpillar and then the chrysalis and the cocoon? And then the final result, the butterfly is a new being with a new identity. The caterpillar was known for crawling on the earth and eating leaves. And those caterpillars eat leaves. The butterfly is known for being able to fly in the air on beautiful wings and drinking nectar from flowers. That old being is gone, right? The old dirty caterpillar is gone. And so is its identity. The caterpillar has no part in that process of change. The Creator did it all. And so the butterfly can never be a caterpillar again, because God did away with that old creation and made a new creation. The same process of change occurs to every person who is in Christ. You understand that? We are new creations. The old has been done away with us. Behold, all has become new. That process of change happens on a daily basis. We metamorphose from that person of sin, that person who lived in the barnyard, in the chicken coop, pecking away with the other chickens. We're moving to become eagles, to become a beautiful creation in Christ. And he changes us from the inside out. This is why our identification is not dependent on our looks, on our possessions, on our homes, on our jobs, on where we go, who we know, what we do. Our identification as believers is in Christ. Do you understand that, church? Can we grab that this morning? We sang some fantastic songs about that today. The worship, I thought, was amazing leading up to this. We are in Christ. Old things have passed away. So you know what that means? We don't have to sin. We don't have to sin. We war with that nature, but we don't have to sin. Listen, I want to read a couple of verses. I may go over about 5 minutes or so. Is that okay? Is that all right? I know I'm Irish. Thank you. Thank you so much. Because this, I think, is important for us. I want to read you some verses. If you can write them down, because I'll read through them fairly quickly, and you can go and reference them later. John 15:15. Jesus said, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. And that's Jesus talking to his disciples in John 15:15. In John chapter 1, verses 12 to 13, yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children not born of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. John 1, 12 to 13. These are glorious truths. Galatians 4, 7. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has also made you an heir. And that means daughters as well, folks. Listen to that. You are no longer a slave, but a son or a daughter. And since you are a son, God has made you also an heir. We are heirs to the glory of heaven with Christ Jesus. We are co-heirs with him. God has given us that privilege of inheriting heaven. And Revelation 1, verses 5 to 6 says this, to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. Do you understand that? He has freed us from our sins by his blood. We are no longer bound to our sins. And has made us to be kings and priests to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. We are kings and priests. We are saints. We don't have to wait until we've been dead to become saints. We are saints now by the blood of Jesus. What did we do to deserve all of this? Nothing. We did nothing to deserve all of this. We have been saved because of God's undeserved love. Are you beginning to get an idea of what your identity in Christ entails? We don't have to walk around feeling sad and down and mopey. We have circumstances that challenge us for sure. And we have circumstances where we feel sad initially. But God has brought to us a greatness and a majesty and a power and a love that is beyond anything we could ever imagine and experience as humans. And he calls us to soar and not to squabble. Listen to this. For if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. Romans 5:10-11. Listen to this as I close. While we were still enemies with God, even before we became Christians, even before he was pulling us to himself, He took down the barrier that stood between him and us, which is sin. That is the barrier. He did that through his son's death. Upon accepting what he's provided, that is the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ and that shed blood, we become his friends, his children, his heirs, and his priests. So anywhere in the world we go, we can identify with men and women of like faith, with families of like faith, with church congregations all over the globe, because we identify in Christ. Are you a believer? Oh, I'm a believer. How many times do we see the fish symbol on the back of a car? And sometimes it gives us a thrill, doesn't it? That's another Christian. There's believers. We go to a different country and we look for a church to worship in. They're believers. They may worship in a different language, but they're believers. They identify with us as we do in Jesus Christ. The freedom to live from the bonds of sin have been given to us, the freedoms in Christ, and the ability to walk in power and in victory are already ours. The victory has been won on the cross. Our sins are cleansed. God chooses not to look at our sins. So far as the east is from the west, so far are our sins away from God. If you go east, you're never going to get west. Think about that for a second. You're just going to keep going east. Right? It's the same with our sins. When God chooses, because of the blood of Christ, to never look at them. And so our sins are not held to our account. And so the identification that we have in Christ is a life of victory and power and joy and honor and peace and patience, goodness, gentleness, meekness, faith. That's in Galatians. You can read that. Men and women, church, as we move forward, it is imperative for us to know and remember and grasp our identity. It's not in what we do. And I'm not saying those things are not important, because they are. But it's not in what we do. It's not in who we know. It's not in how we feel. It's not in where we live. Not in how we look. It's in Jesus Christ. So I just want to reiterate here a couple things and then we're done. In summary, because your identity is in Christ, and I pray that you grab that this morning. You are his friend, his child, and his heir. God's friend, God's child, God's heir. You are also a priest. We are ambassadors to the lost world. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation. God is using us to reconcile the world to himself. You are righteous, alive, forgiven, justified, and redeemed. And when we talk about God not holding our sin to our account, that's being justified. It's a legal term. So God no longer holds our sin to our account. We are justified. And then we are being sanctified. Sanctification is that daily process of becoming more like God, where we spend time with him, we read, we pray, and we live for God. And when we sin, we immediately confess and we repent and we seek God's face to live well and by the power of the Holy Spirit to not do that again. Sanctification is our daily outworking of our justification. We've been reconciled to and accepted by God. We are without blemish, free from accusation, and complete. We are redeemed and free from condemnation. Can that not lift the burden off your shoulders? Just imagine the person who was in court, that woman who was falsely arrested, suddenly realizing and hearing, you are free to go. You are not condemned. We have been given the righteousness of God. We have joined him in his death, burial, and resurrection. As we do that symbolically in baptism, buried in the likeness of his death, raised together in newness of life to walk with him. Listen, our old identity is gone. That old person who used to live in sin and wallow in the pigsty of sin, rolling around in the mud, grunting and being quite happy, it's gone. Because now we are clean and cleansed and pure and fresh. Our old identity is gone. Our new identity is eternal. And then I'll just close with this. We'll close the service with a benediction. You can fly with the eagles, right? Instead of living and pecking with the chickens. All right? Think about that. You can fly with the eagles instead of living in the barnyard of this world. We just close our eyes. If this message has challenged you or encouraged you, I would love to know about it. I'd love to be able to pray with you and talk with you, and so would the elders. God has us. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and for a future and a hope and not harm. And so, church, let's grab onto this identification that we have in Jesus Christ, which is an eternal identification. So now unto him who is able to keep you from stumbling and present you faultless before his throne with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God our Father be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. Together we say, amen.